Canceled. Click start recording. Use the wrong bot hotkey. Last time on a set of glass wind chimes. We did the fights that were the end of session stinger for the session before that. Amalia's group with Cecil, Virgil, and a guest starring Razorface came out into a large spherical cavity with a very large piston that was being like hugged by a horrible arm monster that seems to be affiliated with the golems that are running rampant around Nostos right now. It was very big arm monster, and could sightlessly perceive everything that happened in the area, given the fact that Cecil was incapable of like aggressing on it in Cecil's typical sneaky way. After a failed attempted combo maneuver where Cecil hurls themselves at the arm monster in their signature kill it in one hit move, Amalia swung in to deal a devastating blow, drawing the aggro and then nullifying said aggro with what I am now realizing is a very broken spell, and a lot of enemies are gonna have disintegrate from now on. It was pretty cool though. She was like, "Kapah!" Blew up a bunch of the arms and then created the resilient sphere, and like 100 punches happened and none of them could do shit to shit. And then, more importantly, after killing it, they found a cool materia, and Virgil, while having his power infused by the Primaveral in the almost commonplace ritual now that has happened, that where he like suffuses you guys with his strength. No, it was when this was happening to Cecil. Virgil's like, "All right, I'm gonna talk to the Primaveral again. I want my ice daddy." And he tried doing that, and it started to rapidly kill him. And I was like, "You can keep going if you want." And he did. And Virgil killed himself on the ice ball. Amalia and Cecil both tried to stop him at some point, but, you know, Virgil's gone now, and the ice ball is dissipated into the power that is infused within Cecil, and we didn't do the class feature, so, you know, we're all guilty of that. I'm not pointing any fingers, Stuart, Fergus, not my fault. Then the other party. The other party fought a bunch of smaller golems, and one of them almost died, but didn't, because Sayako did a sick warding flare move. And that fight was a lot more Kane accidentally exploding everything around himself, and Sayako fucking running to all the theme park rides and weaponizing them against the golems.
Attraction.
Things worked out, and the assistance that Ilium asked of you in an exchange for. Not an exchange for, but leading up to Catherine's like fixation on the black the Umbra skein that you guys went back to the like, or are you on your way back? Have you gotten back yet?
I'm not sure.
All right. Well, it's nothing.
You aren't back. No.
Okay, they're on their way. Perfect. So given that Caro is in the other group but also gone, we can technically start with either of you.
Hello world.
What's up? I just finished the recap and explaining why Virgil is still winning the stress. Blue ribbon.
John, I can't stress this enough. If you shout while you're in the same room as Charlie, we can still hear you.
Yes, that is kind of what I was doing.
I'm really excited for when Jonah finally like has a big comedic anvil land directly on his head.
In real life.
In real life. Please.
All right, so
I bet
you have a big comedic hammer.
Who wants to start?
I'm good with the suspicion staying just a little bit longer.
No, actually, no. Wait, you're here, so we could start with you as well.
On the I want to see what's going on with Virgil dying and pissing off Iceman.
Sick. Yeah, let's do that then.
Yes.
Okay.
Let me actually. So, Virgil, let's go over the things that you saw most recently. There was a small crystalline ball of light that was familiar to you, as these have appeared on ice sculpture altars that have appeared interposed on existence whenever the Primaveral has gifted you and yours with power. And despite its familiarity, your connection to the Primaveral was cut by one of Razorface's weapons in the conflict with him. And through whatever desire you acted upon, you elected to try and forcibly resituate that connection through so simple a thing as using the Septuagint and your physical touch to grasp at this power. So, in addition to all of the, because of course there was a ton of this, just pain everywhere, to your body and to your soul, the world would also have started to fractal in on itself. And Euclidean geometry would have become incredibly pervasive. Angles and lines forcing themselves onto normally curvaceous surfaces. And given you were in a large, like, kind of cave-like room, there were a lot of those. And very, very quickly, it added to the extreme pain that you were already feeling with this intense migraine. In accompaniment of also an extreme cold. But you didn't give up. And by give up, I mean you successfully killed yourself. You sat there and took it until you literally couldn't anymore, and now you're gone. You feel this feeling of suspension, this almost compression in your chest as you feel this desire to fall, but no possible way to enact that desire. And it's black all around you. You can't tell if your eyes are open. And this is not the first time you've felt this. However, for the first time, when you open your eyes, because, yeah, they were closed, spoiler alert, there's a thin veil separating you from what looks like the surface of some body of water. And this isn't the frozen lake. This is almost as if you were looking down on a small underground pond, probably 10 feet above it. And it's that body of water that this innate desire to fall is pulling you towards. But alas, the veil is in front of you. And sitting immersed in that body of water is a familiar shape, though not without its differences. It is Calliope.
Interesting.
Roll a perception check, Virgil.
All right, let me. It would probably help if I, you know, actually got into the game, wouldn't it?
I would, yeah.
Does a 45 get it? I'd be saying if I was Amalia. That is the quickest this page has ever fucking loaded for me.
Pog. Perception, please.
Alright.
Your brain, hand it over.
Actually, I'm the one that does the
brain. Baba Biba, stop LARPing, hit the button.
If you respond to Fergus in character again, I'm killing Virgil permanently and banning you from the campaign.
Perception.
We will just pretend that the intro took the entire first loop of the song. Thank you. There's little, like, prickly feelings around your extremities. You're being reconstituted, but much slower than the first time.
Interesting. Interesting. Hello, Claire. So, being reconstituted, but like, how's it like when I, what happens when I wiggle my fingers then? Is it still?
So as you start trying to wiggle your fingers, your thoughts first go to your fingers, and your perspective on Calliope shifts as, it takes you a second to realize, but you're now looking at the same scene you were, but from the perspective of your hands.
Okay.
It looks like your consciousness is following your thoughts.
That's kind of cool. Technically speaking, this would be a good spot to be like, oh, hey, what do I look like? Blah, blah, blah. Like, could you imagine that for a first session? That would be dope as hell. Please don't. Oh, I'm going to have a lot of yarn to clean up later. So, since that's how that's going, I can't quite move or push anything then. Actually, I suppose that is a question then. What happens when I try to use my consciousness to push against the veil?
You feel it start to decouple from your body.
Okay, so we're not doing that then.
It's a very strenuous task, and you'd have to try really hard to do it, but it feels like that's what that would do. Is there anything in particular you want to act on, or are you just waiting?
I can't particularly act on much, since when I think of something to do, the consciousness flits around about the body part that does it. So theoretically then, if I were to try talking, the consciousness would just point of view Virgil's mouth.
Yeah, but you can still make the attempt. It's not like that's the end of the thought.
Okay, I will make the attempt to say hello.
Calliope.
Yeah.
You have been here for either a very short time, very long time, or both. And the only thing you're really sure of is how, despite being this this nice lukewarm temperature, this water, or whatever the liquid is, has been very uncomfortable. And, at odds with all that you know. There's some kind of bipolarity to it that is anathema to your very existence, but it's everywhere. And it's shallow, only about 6 inches deep in this strange place with no curvature or landmarks, just the liquid over a featureless plane. And still very vivid in your mind, in addition to whatever else you've been thinking about, is the rush of the wind against your face as you were plunging off of the usurped's body. And then the preceding conversation with the strange ice creature that greeted you at the end of your existence. So if you would like a moment to go over what's been in Calliope's head and or describe yourself in any facet, you can do that.
I have been pseudo-dropped into this with nothing on my head, so give me a second.
No problem. I can cut to someone else if you want.
No, it's fine. Just, I think Calliope has just been doing the, like if you put someone in isolation for long enough, time starts to just not exist anymore. People just like start to kind of lose it, but no,
solitary
far more quiet.
Solitary confinement is a hell of a drug.
Yep. And with this, in the almost what felt like and what still feels like infinity, I think that they forgot a lot, and I think that they remember very few, very sparse things, as both their mental and their physical form slowly but surely changed in this kind of desolate hellhole.
So it's much closer to the, it's been an impossibly long amount of time than it is.
Yeah. I think that, yeah, no, absolutely. It has not been a period brief enough to like it could have been 20 minutes, but it's been 20 minutes for eternity.
Yep.
So a typical Monday work day.
The audience laughs. As they've just been walking in a singular direction for like this entire time. And what feels like every single step of the way, they're losing an amount of what they remember about the real world as they slowly but surely come to, fuck, I don't know, it's hell. It's literal hell. It's actually just the ninth layer of hell. I don't know. Eric?
Great.
You didn't give me much. Sorry.
There's very little there. I wasn't asking for a lot.
The mentality alone that you gave was a plenty. In
my
opinion.
From your guys' perspective, do you think Calliope notices Virgil?
It really depends, in my opinion, on this veil and how exactly it separates things. And theoretically, if the veil is weak-ish, that would be something new that Calliope would see, I suppose. But I don't know entirely about this veil situation. Nor, at least that's my thoughts on it.
Fergus?
I thought you asked the rest of the party.
No, I was asking specifically you two.
Oh. Well, I would be happy to do either, honestly. I am fine with the idea. Just roll a d2.
No. So you you've been walking for eternity, and you've always known that there's this divide in the nothingness that goes everywhere about 10 feet up, and you have no way of getting to it. And this time there's something beyond that. Just this smoky weight directly above you and following as you proceed at your very slow pace. And accompanying it is the energy of something that may once have been familiar.
I think this is the first time that they stopped in this entire length of, not even time, lack thereof of time, this nentropic hellhole, as they kind of reach up with a hand that they cannot tell whether or not is emaciated, and try and reach to this bizarre new weight that is completely foreign in this eternally fucking the same place.
Great! And now we're gonna switch to Amalia, Cecil, and Razorface.
Cecil's in the... He's in the Primavera's realm. We knocked him the fuck out.
He's lying there.
His body. Amalia, Razorface, and Cecil's body.
So this is right after you have punched out Cecil. And Razorface has watched this happen. And he silently comes over and takes his rifle off of his back and places the barrel against the ground and clasps his hands over the stock and looks at you, Amalia.
Amalia is just sort of kind of a little after the exertion of just punching Cecil the fuck out. She's sort of licking her arm because this is it, basically. If shit goes down and shit goes down elsewhere, there's nothing she can do at this particular moment. She eventually just looks up and says, I don't suppose you know where in Eden they are right now.
I know very little about what has just transpired. I elected not to intervene.
When we had our...
You go.
When we had our link to the Primavera, whenever we lost consciousness, we would be transported here to Eden. And it seems like while we are here, whenever we are knocked out, we go to the Primavera's location. I say we, but fuck, I have no idea what Virgil was trying to do.
There's a moment of consideration that he takes as his head turns slightly away from you and looks at where Virgil used to be. And he says, how many of you are there left tied to him?
Cecil and Kavi.
There is barely parsable a tone of surprise to his voice. As he continues and says, I will not lie, I thought I did away with him.
From my understanding, you nearly did.
Would you have me finish the job?
And this Amalia sighs. This is going to sound completely crazy. And she looks around. She looks around for a second. And she looks at the man in front of him with who's been given the powers of a god and the rubble that's behind her of the giant golem creature. It's like, alright, in retrospect, and given where we are, you know, it's up there, but fair point.
The question posed was a thought experiment, not an offer. I'm glad to see that you still have the resolution to do everything else as well as defy my orders to kill you.
Primavera, the scientist, all these others, they were created by a desperate race to try and save them, but they're long gone. Primavera's realm is frozen over. I think he's following his original program. He's trying to take Jericho at the cost of Eden.
And no doubt he thinks himself noble for it.
She does not at that.
At this, he just like using the knuckles on his right hand, knocks out the ammunition canister of his rifle and slides some different rounds in before pushing it back into place and picking it up off the ground. Amalia. True Namer. Your blood is not Eleusian. And this is a subject we have skirted for long enough, I think. Where is Lothian?
At this, Amalia just I am mindful of the fact that we are working together, but I am also mindful of the fact that I don't betray those who place their trust in me easy. But since it doesn't actually matter, I will tell you. He's everywhere and nowhere. He appears when he wants, or wherever he wants. There's very little I can do. Pin him down.
It is as you say. There are things that we should be cognizant of, no matter what alliances, however temporary they may be, that we forge. I am keen to see through to the end of this. He nods towards the massive piston in the center of this chamber and the remains of the hecatonk here. I am also curious about your musings of the Tenebrae and its meddlings in Nostos, if that is what is happening.
So, what do you you think the factory is, because you must have known something of it. Each Sentra is there.
As much as I would love to answer questions, there's something rather difficult that I have been trying to think through, and that is potential alternatives to laying you low. And I think I've come up with one.
Ooh, goody.
No.
If you abandon your surname and become Hale and One of the Eleusians, I will no longer feel obliged to hunt you. Or I can take Lothian instead.
Let me ask you a question first before we discuss this. When was the last time you had contact with Lucian?
I am aware of how few of us remain.
Because I have heard nothing of them, aside from yourself, since I've been here.
He gives a slow nod and says, well, I would not consider myself incredibly versed in the subject, given as recent as it is, and how widespread my own dealings are. But as long as I draw breath, the lineage remains. And with that, so does the dogma. You have heard my offers. I will give you time to think them over. How long are we going to wait for your friend to wake up?
She looks staring at the two of them. I have no idea how long these would take. We might have
Virgil's
to go
shattered,
in.
Right?
Yeah, Virgil.
Yeah.
Virgil's uh-oh.
It's just Cecil. I have no
it's
idea.
It's just Cecil in a puddle.
Yeah, I have no idea how long this might take. It might be better for... Can you teleport them back to, you teleport Cecil back to... Lagoon?
There's like this discomfort that comes about his shoulders as the prospect of teleporting to Lagoon comes up, and you sense that it's kind of a sore subject. So he says, no, but you can. And he takes something off of his belt and tosses it to you. It's a small kind of collapsible sphere that pulsates with red light at a few different points on its surface.
Yeah, it's a Pokeball.
It's kind of a cyberpunk Pokeball. This is one of the devices that you just toss and it creates a temporary portal.
So when is it going to be revealed that he's a Keyblade wielder?
I mean, I've just been very, very specific with describing his rifle.
Alright, so Amalia is going to... Knowing something of the mechanics of teleportation, she's going to picture Lagoon in her mind.
And bing, then... bada boom, bada bop, the thing happens. Cecil's lying on the couch. Except, actually, Cecil is watching his fist... in contact with the wind chime in the middle of the pillar of ice back in the sepulcher. The wind chime itself has been broken in half and is slowly pulling itself together. And you can't move your arm. It's up to the elbow, just completely kind of caught in this frozen... It's like a popsicle stick where your arm's fine, but just like up to the elbow, it's in the ice, touching the wind chime that is broken and pulling itself back together. And reality around you is not as it used to be. The chamber that this took place in is broken up into massive, like, jagged pizza cuts that have pulled away from one another, leaving these gaping holes into a black emptiness beyond.
The Primavera was still there last time, right?
Yes, he was.
But now he is not?
He is not.
Fantastic. So what I understand is that I need to pull my arm out of this so it doesn't get crunched between the reformed wind chime.
Yeah.
Alright, and it's in ice, correct?
It's currently in ice.
Does this plane have any shadows?
Yep.
Fantastic. I'm gonna reserve a point of passive effort. Are any of said shadows in a range of 200 feet?
They sure are.
Cecil will attempt to utilize this very pleasant, very funky teleportation tactic given to them by Valdana. Does it work?
It does, yeah. And you get out, and the Windchime is still very slowly reconstituting itself. And now that you're closer to one of the very many fractures that have perforated this the sepulcher, you realize that the plane itself is also reforming at a similar pace, except these pieces are a lot bigger, so it's a little more noticeable. And then the first thought hits you. The first thought that is not your own at all. The cry of agony of the Primavera and what he's currently going through as it just washes over this entire place.
Cool. Thanks, Virgil.
And with it, there is this overpowering winter wind that erupts from the gaps in the reality and just billows towards the pillar of ice that is holding the wind chime before just like being consumed. And snow is blowing everywhere for a second until it's clear, and then there's another 6 or 7 seconds before it happens again, and Cecil's clothes just billow around them under the onslaught of this that thing that I described.
So Cecil remembers that it's not just the destruction of the wind chime, it's its reformation as well.
Yeah.
As they trudge back to it, if available, like if that's something doable.
It requires some hopscotching, but yeah, no, Cecil has a lot of mobility available to them, as well as...
Yeah, some of it aided by the teleportation, and yeah. As they make it back to the ice pillar with the wind chime on it, and it's slowly putting itself back together, right?
Very slowly.
Does it look like this process could be aided?
Your intuition tells you that the reason it's coming back together is intimately tied to your Rockhumin ability.
Hmm. Would melting the ice around it be an idea to assist it?
Yeah. Probably.
Nice.
You melt the ice and then you just like manually use your hands to try and pull
it
back together.
Yeah, Cecil is a person of simple values and understandings of the world. As they snap their fingers and attempt to cause Rahimim to melt the ice around this split of glass wind chimes.
Sure, it works.
Nice. And then they trudge through the snow and ice. Frost is lining the furthest parts of their, like, the furthest parts of their body away from the core of their new kind of, like, brass? Iron, gold, brass, I think. Brass? Brass frame.
Brass is hydraulic.
Yes, okay. As they grab one side of the wind chime and the other side of the wind chime and... Just in the same way you see like a superhero being like
it's Captain America making sure the helicopter can't get away from the bay.
Yeah, exactly. Thank you. Yes. As they attempt
to check.
Yeah! I love strength checks. They're my favorite.
You do it.
Way to
crit, buddy.
Yeah, damn. Love to see that, huh?
So after a brief moment of extreme difficulty,
like there's steam jettisoning out of the like pipes lining the back of Cecil's arms, as this is not easy. They're not a particularly strong person, but like there's just like a quick like shot of their mouth opening is like they cry out and then there's just a as they slam it together.
The screams of pain are replaced with silence, as in the same motion of the wind chime reforging, the plane itself also reforges itself and pulls back inward and locks in the rest of the away the rest of the gaps into the black nothingness, and you don't see Virgil anywhere. If there's anything particular you'd like to be up to right now, you can do that, but otherwise I'm going to go to the other party.
Did the sepulchre chime reconstitute? Is that clock
full? Yeah. When it came into contact with itself, it looked like it reforged. And as you were touching it, it was of a material you've never experienced before. It was like
Cecil's never touched glass.
It was glass, but you know how glass is made of sand?
Yeah.
It was like simultaneously the sheer like smooth intensity of glass, but still very much you could like almost see every individual of the millions of grains of sand.
Oh, that's fun. I think at this, Cecil looks back, not seeing Virgil, and instead just calls out for the Primavera.
Roll a charisma check.
Okay. I'm going to push that, because funny. Funny too.
Alright, so what this feels like to you is... it's almost like, I guess, your existence stretching an arm out to an individual that is drowning, and that thing taking hold of your arm, your offered support, and that thing being way, way larger than you, and using you to try and pull itself back to safety. It does not do so forcefully. If you follow through with this, you're going to be consumed.
And this is the Primavera?
This is the Primavera, yeah.
And consumption in this situation is what?
He's gonna eat you to get power back.
It's very probably obliteration.
I have a really interesting idea that I have no idea what'll happen if I do it.
Hold on. As this happens, Death in the West starts screeching. And, like, for the first time, not attacking you in a harmful way, but in a way that still hurts. And
yeah.
Like a cat trying to claw, like, your arm away from something.
In these few seconds, I would like to ask and then probably roll a dice as to figure out what would happen if in the few seconds of before total annihilation, Cecil were to assume Rahimim on themselves.
Might work.
Might work?
Yeah, might work.
No dice needed for that?
No, I'm going to roll a D100, but might work.
Ooh.
Consider what you know about Rahimim. what happens when Rahimim wears off?
Yeah, but I think but the end goal is to get X out of safety. And if X is on safety and the obliteration passes through if it's a non-static thing and it's just a reaction to being pulled up, then once pulled up and used as a stepping stone, it will no longer be obliterative.
Alright, so if you want to go through with this, I'm going to ask you the same thing I asked Caro. Are you okay with Cecil go bye-bye?
It would be funny if Cecil go bye-bye.
So yes, you're okay with that potentiality?
I think so, I mean, yeah.
You know, if Cecil go bye-bye, he don't have to play two characters at once.
I mean, I guess that's true. You get, however, this deal, you get to decide if high is good or bad.
High is always good. Three away from Cecil go bye-bye. Oh, wow. So, yeah, in this metaphor of Cecil being on a harbor, helping up, something way, way larger than Cecil, you use Rahimim on yourself and freeze, but nothing changes from your perspective just because of how it works. Mm-hmm. And there's an instant where you're just gone. But, thankfully, Rahimim's made of the stuff that that this guy can do. So I'm going to roll this real fast. You take a level 4 harm. But
based.
You give him 4 recover juice as the Primaveral instantly realizing what you've done makes sure that you do not go bye-bye. And, but he's not there in front of you. You can sense him in everything.
Okay.
And, you're not sure, but, as your senses come back, you swear that, like, your arm was outstretched in front of you, but you couldn't see it. But now there it is. It was just a trick of the light. All right, great. So, other party time. Boop, 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 boop. Scoop. What's the song? Yeah, what's up?
Can we have it where after doing all this, like just pushing herself through the Emilite anti-magic bullshit, she's kind of sort of passed out for a short while.
Is Danger Plant Princess carrying Sayako?
Yes.
It looks pretty undignified, but
perfect.
I am here, by the way, just
alright, so the rest of you are walking the metal roads of the Iron Streets and back to the central hub that the large cylindrical building you met with Ilium in presides over.
And he's so bursting to, you know, jumping from side to side, you know, trying to hold back the questions the way, you know, like you dance around when you have to go to the bathroom. Practically.
Is there something up with you?
Wait, is that in character?
Yeah, that's Ilium asking. I know we just got done talking about moving forward with the Umber skein hunting, but
Right. So, you know, I'm waiting so we can get to stuff. Right.
We're gonna have to go up to the ballast bridges. That's right. Kind of a big part of it.
Right, so I'm gonna have to wait for it, so I'm just, you know, waiting.
You don't have to go to the bathroom or anything?
No.
Alright, just checking.
I went before we left.
He looks at you, Kane, like with a slight look of concern, like with an eyebrow raised.
Cane shrugs.
All right. So, he leads you all up to the counter, and you all get exactly 101 gold.
101 gold, huh?
All right. Man, I'm rich! I'm rich!
Ilium just, like, gently lays Sayako's coin pouch, like, across her abdomen, and looks at the rest of you. So, this probably isn't going to be something Magnium Packs or Rust are involved with, and frankly, that's probably for the best, how they handled that last thing. So maybe this is just an us thing, he postulates in your direction, Catherine.
She's nodding, still looking like, you know, like she's, like, fit to burst.
Alright, means we've got to track down Sarkic. And Sarkic is a sucker for the... What does he call it? The art of writing or some such. So we're going to have to come up with a letter. Me and him had a bit of a falling out the last time we worked together. So you're probably going to take point. Is that okay?
Oh, sure, sure.
Well, I guess I'll wait here then. And he just moves over to the bar. So he essentially told you, time to write a letter to Sarkic to try and get him to help you with the Umber skein hunting.
Okay. Does he like science?
As he realizes you're continuing to talk to him, Ilium looks over his shoulder and stops walking away, and he says, probably. I don't know. Just because we were partners doesn't mean, like, we were friends. You get me?
All right.
You might have to do some poking around on him on your own time. But, you know, don't wait up. I've got a pretty good liver. And he continues walking over to the bar.
All right.
Kane, what are you doing?
Probably kind of eyeing the materia that we haven't decided to go into it now. I'm just kind of like, He's thinking back on his, you know, little project of the whole Emilis and materia combination shenanigan, you know?
You do notice that there seems to be a fairly mobile looking, not like a food, I guess it is close to a food cart, but it's on like a system of like little indents in the ground that it can ride around on. It looks like some kind of materia affixing station. It's currently unoccupied and doesn't look like anyone's manning over it. But you've seen these sorts of things around. You see the familiar sorts of apparatuses that would not forge materia, but like put them into things. Notably, it seems like there's a different kind of make to it than everything else in Nostos. It's very clearly foreign and has been juxtaposed here by someone from, you know, the place you come from, as opposed to the place these weird insect people and Ariam come from.
So is Ilium still around, or is anyone he can talk to still around?
Ilium has gone over to the bar. You can go talk to him.
Yeah,
you
sure
also noticed that Danger Plan is still carrying Sayako.
Oh.
She kind of rolls over and mutters something about tempura.
And you also probably remember that there's a semi-serious investigation being conducted on the A-Factory. But that was being headed by Amalia, who is plenty competent.
thinking, just kind of thinking about, like, do we have the time to be distracted any further? It's a fun fight. Maybe I should get back to helping those kids. So he's gonna look around for Kavi, Catherine, what's her
name? Yeah, she's right there. Oh. She it looks like she's sat herself down at a table and is furiously writing things out.
So, rather than disturb her, because she looks very engrossed in there, he's just going to walk up to Ilium and ask, hey, who installed that materia apparatus? Do you know?
He spins around on the stool he's sitting at, and he says, oh yeah, that's one of the fixtures the Lagoons got set up. They have those things all over the place, usually for their own usage, but occasionally they'll take commissions. Why do you ask?
Just curious. I could have sworn that I know something about them, but oh well.
Well, he kind of gestures for you to come in a little closer.
He does.
How much do you know about Lagoon?
Not a whole lot. They seem pretty mysterious.
Yeah, well, that's kind of for a reason. They're a little bit infamously clandestine. And in addition to that, accommodative of outsiders. He gives you, like, a knowing smirk, as if to imply that he knows more than he lets on.
Cain can't help but grin a little bit, because he's like, fight, fight, fight. But he's like, nope, nope, behave. Ah. Well. Is there anything you wanted to know about them? Because I think I have a connection or two.
Apart from, like, a relatively outstanding debt that Fenneca owes me. No. Lagoon, another thing they're known for is not really delivering on pay in comparison to a lot of the other factions here.
Is that so?
Yeah, So it's been a while since I've been around those parts. The exclusivity, it's a little bourgeois for me as well.
Yeah, I get that. Thank you, though.
No problem.
So, he's just gonna sit back at the table next to Kavi and Danger.
Sends you off with what looks like a whiskey. Just clearly pleased with the interaction.
Huh. Guess we got more eyes than us. He's gonna like walk away talking to himself. Guess we got more eyes than us than we thought. Oh well. Can we guess that would be him? He's gonna sit down next to Kavi and just feel like, how goes that letter you're writing?
Oh, tell me, do you think this looks good?
He's gonna look at it. It's friendly. I'd definitely be on board for it if I were him, but I'm also, you know, me.
Do you want to read it out loud, Shawnee?
Dear Sarkis, I am Kavi, a visiting scientist, and visiting is crossed out. And now it says returning. And I came across a kind of black box and told it's called an Umbris team. I'm told you would be able to tell me more about it. Want to go hunting Umbris together?
Hunt's all good and fun and whatnot, but I suppose not knowing much about the guy, you're not sure what to entice him with, eh?
No, not really. Besides Umbris.
Well, could always think Lagoon could have information on that fella. I don't know.
The two of you notice somebody kind of tentatively approaching.
Tentative.
Yeah, from behind you. Do you turn around?
Yeah.
Great. Yeah. So, yeah, you recognize that this is Magnia, one of the people that assisted the fights that you guys had just gotten in with the golems. And it looks like she's casted a few worried glances in Danger Plan's direction. She's been patched up considerably from the condition she was in upon your guys' arrival. And as she gets close enough, she says, your friend's gonna be okay, right?
Oh, my plan?
No, you're
So Kane's gonna get up, walk by Sayako, see if she's still, like, sleep-talking.
She rolls over a little bit, and there's a big, doofy, drooling grin on her face. Whatever she's dreaming about, it's definitely a happier place.
Yeah, I'm sure she'll be okay after some rest.
Can I ask a few questions, if you don't mind?
If we can answer them, we'll help.
You guys must have seen it, right? What she did with the solar cannon?
She powered it or something, right?
It was really bright. Unfortunately, I wasn't able to get a closer look because it was, you know, bright.
I was, fending off being concussed a little bit myself.
It appeared as if she had transmogrified a massive portion of the wall into sheer luminescence. I've never
seen that. Wow, I hope she can tell me how to do that when she wakes up.
Certainly is interesting.
Magnia rubs her head a little bit frustratively.
What's your conjecture as to what it could have been then?
It's fine.
Wait.
It's fine.
Oh.
I'll... at this point, Sayako is finally stirred. She's kind of like, she starts to get up and then she, how well is Danger Plant holding on to her?
Danger Plant's real big, so... You're basically lying in a root hammock.
Okay. Alright, so she kind of just... She doesn't tumble out and fall on her face, but she does kind of roll out of it. I suppose it's really hard to obscure the sun sometimes. Sorry, metaphors. But... I'm not actually from around here.
Hey, how loud do you say that?
Less than an indoor voice.
Alright, so it's just with Magnia. A very, very sudden tension grips her form. And it doesn't look like she can find any particular words right now.
You mean that your parents left when you were a baby too? And you're returning here?
No one tries lying.
I was trying to, you know, divert the conversation, but...
Do you have that charisma score for if you're not gonna lie?
Nope.
I came up here to find some answers to something.
The tension is still there, and so is the speechlessness. It looks like her mind is going a million places a second.
Sayako puts her hands on her hips and leans back, does a little bit of a stretch, a little bit of a neck bend. I come in peace?
Kvig, like, kind of inches away from her, you know, nervously looking to see how this is gonna go down.
Roll persuasion, Sayako.
Sayako goes, meow.
Basically.
Nya?
Con?
Ooh. Ooh.
What's the box?
Am I not seeing any rolls here?
All right. Right. That's right. My heckin' browser crashed, and now I have to bring up my character sheet again.
Shucks.
All right. So it's gonna be a persuasion check, basically to convince Magnia that Sayako's intent is benign.
Yep. Great, great. She very, very rigidly points to one of the seats at the table Catherine is sitting at. And then she goes and takes a seat herself.
Okay.
That one.
Sayako's gonna follow suit.
Well,
I'm going to make this crystal clear. I'm only doing this because you saved my life.
Well, at least it was worth something.
How long have you been here?
Sayaka leans back and she kind of glances at Kavi and Kane. She's kind of wondering that herself.
It's been almost 3 days.
3 days longer than, well, 2 days longer than I really expected to be here.
And do you know what shift it's on?
Shifters as in...
Shifteds, not ters.
Oh, shifteds. History check?
Yeah, go ahead. See if you know what you ate for breakfast. Yeah, you very vaguely remember Fenica bringing up shifteds as one of the things that are very dangerous here.
Ah, yeah. Something I should try to avoid.
It's something you're going to become. You can't stay here.
Oh.
There's a very audible gulp.
So, let me guess. The longer we're here, cat's out of the bag, Sayaka, at least those two.
She just buries her head in her hands.
But anyways, as he's like saying in a very low, quiet voice, so longer we stay here, more of a chance our existence won't agree with this area. A little obvious to us, but...
You haven't seen any, have you?
Not yet.
I mean, we wouldn't know, I suppose.
Would you like to?
Depends if that's from a safe distance or if it's from the inside.
She nods rapidly. It's safe.
Oh, here. In that case, yeah.
She hurriedly gets up from the table and gestures for you guys to follow her as she goes to a kind of a dustier looking staircase that leads down from one of the walls in this large cylindrical foyer. And soon enough, you guys are descending a relatively dusty, inclined hallway that follows the curvature of this building. And you come to a small room as the hallway broadens out into a corridor with its left wall being consisted of cells cut off with bars in the area you're in. And all of these cells are vacant except for a couple at the very end. And it is these two cells that she leads you to. She gestures to the one on her right. And what you see is it looks like the shadows that were inhabiting the horrible lightning storm creature you fought on the lift on your way here. Or, Kane, it looks like the cognizant shadows that were spilling out from between the machinery of the bowels of said lift. Except they seem a lot more, not docile in this form, but intentful and malicious and intelligent. As what you're looking at is, it's really creepy. It has really long, skinny limbs that instead of being smoky, look like they're made of this black glass, like obsidian. And it doesn't have a head, but it has eyes going down its torso and portions of its body. It looks like they're glitching. Like they'll like for a couple of seconds be 6 inches away from the rest of what they're attached to before going back. And it looks like that sort of effect plagues its entire existence, as it'll change positions in the cell at kind of at random. It doesn't seem aware that you're looking at it. And Magnia says, "That is what we call a silent. And this one is a clicker." And she turns to the other cell, where also made of this weird black obsidian substance. It looks kind of like an aerial drone. It's like this spherical base with pieces of machinery coming out of it, and a large central red eye that's darting around trying to take in as many details as possible. You guys quickly intuit that these cells are kind of one-way doors where you can tell what's on the other side, but they cannot perceive anything outside of the cell. Shifteds are extremely dangerous, and if what I've heard is to be believed, rapturous changes to your sense of self will occur, accompanying a ravenous hunt.
So, how long does it usually take for these kind of changes to happen?
I was led to believe that it was a very, very, very fast process. I didn't even know that there was this strange intermission that you seem to be in. Are you all? Forgive the confusion, but Arium don't come from outside. What are you?
So, but are there Arium? There must be who, you know, like, leave the city? Maybe with their little Arium babies in tow?
She kind of cocks her head. And go where?
I don't know. Sentra was down in...
I'm gonna roll a history check.
Eric, remind me what the name of the district was.
The Sylvan District. No recognition seems to come over her eyes.
Alright, well, I guess I'm going to have to rewrite that letter then.
That explains why we can't leave as we normally are.
Alright, so... So, if you take a shifted out of the city, does it revert back to normal?
Are you talking about where the lifts go?
Yeah.
Well, that should answer your question. We're from beyond the lifts.
There's a moment of kind of disdainful clarity in her eyes as she says, "There's a lot of people that don't think the lifts actually go anywhere. And up until about 3 seconds ago, I was one of them."
Well, they didn't until we fixed. I mean,
it seemed to be maybe a one-time job. See, Nostos and where we're from do not agree with each other as well. Kind of why we're here.
Well, I can tell you that So let me go into a bit more detail, just to explain exactly where I'm coming from. The people that don't think the lifts actually go anywhere thought that they were being used as a scapegoat, because there's a lot of points of rhetoric that are telling us that the shifteds are only here because the lifts were in use. They're also used to move around industrial material and assist with building new structures, and well, we assumed that that was just being shut down as a way to kind of placate us. I thought that, you know, the problem was more interior. But clearly I was wrong. What about your place contrasts with this place in a way that would create this? And she gestures to the silent.
Well, there's kind of these two worlds that are trying to merge with each other, and it's really not good for either world, so we're trying to figure out how to stop that.
Not entirely sure, but figure Emilis and you, we don't have Emilis where we're from. It's kind of a really odd interaction with our world. That thing Sayako did is an ability that quite a few people on our side can do. No, hard to believe, maybe, but it literally is just kind of magic. And we really don't seem to be able to do that very well here. That could be, I don't know, one leading theory. Our magical world and your Emilis world just don't like each other.
She rubs her head and says, okay, so if you can, like, outwardly tell what things that you can typically do that don't mesh well with this place are, I would advise not to use them.
Yeah, I think it was kind of a last-ditch effort from Sayako to, you know.
Like I said, you did save my life. So I also feel really out of my element all of a sudden. I'm going to be honest, I think I've only retained maybe half of what you've told me. Kind of feel like I'm going to throw up, but I just don't want to... I don't want your guys' heads on the bounty board in a week.
We'll try to be careful. Definitely.
And also, don't tell people what you told me, because you haven't saved their lives yet, Saya.
Co.
Co?
She just tacks on at the end of that.
What's Co?
Sayako. That's actually my true name.
You... Why did you need pseudonyms?
What do you think?
Do people here... Would they recognize...
It's not so much that, but...
I'm gonna go rest. I think the blood's getting to my head. And she just leads you guys back up to the... Or I guess if you choose to follow, you can go back up to the main chamber of the cylinder.
Sayaka's gonna look back at the shifter.
Shifted.
As you concern. Look,
as you look at the cell that the silent was inside, it's gone.
What?
And then 6 or 7 seconds later, it's back. And this time it's in one of the corners of the ceiling. Kind of adhering to the wall. These things are really creepy.
Yeah.
That's scary. Wait, is my mic working?
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay, yeah. Funny.
Can I just interrupt for 1 second to address what I feel is a very important issue?
What's up?
Has Virgil supposed to have been black this entire time?
What do you mean? Like a black person?
Yes.
Have you not seen his sprite?
No. Not with enough detail to tell. I've literally been imagining him as the fucking thing that you have as your icon.
Yeah, when your icon, when your profile icon is the only point of reference.
It was a placeholder. Anyway.
For what?
Anyway.
But when I actually found one.
You got a half hour and a half anyway.
So, yeah, you guys go back to the main chamber. Kvi, you look down at the letter that you've are assumedly making changes to.
Yep. Gotta cross out returning also.
I'm gonna say that I am Kvi, a scientist. I'm also gonna say that what's his face? Ilium left you with the address of Sarkic, which is a little complex here because it looks like addresses in Gnostos are weird. And, you know, it makes sense that they're weird because this city moves around constantly. It re-tetrises itself into different shapes. Retaining, like, the general layout of the districts. What's up?
Isn't he still here drinking?
Ilium is, yeah, but he doesn't, like... He intended to, like, be apart from you for a while.
Okay. Okay, anyway.
So, it looks like in order to get to Sarkic, you're gonna have to wait until a certain time period as well. And you're not quite sure why, but it's, like, 17 hours from now.
Alright. Danger plant, make a note in my appointment book. 17 hours from now, find Sarkic. And Danger plant's shrugging like, you don't have an appointment book.
Well, I will say, if it wasn't obvious already, we definitely, as a group, not just us, but what's her face and the rest of you guys. Forgot her name again sometimes. Was it Amalia? Amalia, yeah. Seems like
I wonder if it was possible to take a shifted away and see what happens with it.
Wrapped
it up really securely.
I don't know. Did you not see the thing just blink out of existence of that room momentarily?
Yeah, but then it returned.
Yeah, but like
holding it in place, even if it's well, I guess
I don't think it can be very well steady, restrained. But... I don't even understand how that's being held in there. The floaty thing, whatever the weird eyeball. That I can kind of get. But that thing...
Well, I can dream. Try not to turn into one, okay?
I'm assuming our little transformation is staving that off. So... I guess kind of definitely stuck like this in public, no matter what. On that note, like I was trying to say, we definitely have eyes on us. So let's try to be a little bit more inconspicuous. Somehow. I guess.
Sorry.
I really want one.
Honestly, I'm intrigued to fight one of those things, so I can get that.
So, just making sure, like, shifteds are people. You guys got that part, right?
Yeah, they left echoes, but echoes
I guarantee
like
you
really
Kvi got that part.
Alright, so she still wants one. Great. Are you guys heading back to Lagoon, or are you chilling here, or what?
Kane would like to go back to Lagoon.
What are Sayako and Catherine doing? Are they going with him?
If they have no more business here, Sayako wants to go back to Lagoon so that she can unrobotify herself again.
Well, Catherine's going to wander over to the street and see why you can only go there in 17 hours.
So, alright. So, Sayako Kane. You guys get back to Lagoon, and as you do, just because I want to give you guys some potential screen time with him, you watch as Amalia steps out of one of the redshifted portals that Razorface was using in the fight against him. and lies Cecil down on a couch.
Is Virgil, like, he's like doing a head count. It's like, we got Amalia, we got Cecil, yeah.
Virgil is not there.
What happened to Catboy?
So Amalia looks...
He sublimated.
Huh.
From solid to gas.
Yeah, he essentially did.
He disappeared into the aether. He is gone. He is missing.
Amalia looks up. It's just... Virgil has done something incredibly fucking stupid. Zizel is trying to resolve it right now.
Well,
at least I hope that is what's happening.
Do we get an off-screen recap?
Yeah.
Sure.
Okay. Yeah, that tracks. So what does Cecil actually plan to do in there? Did he tell you? They. Them.
I do not know if there is anything that can be done. I need to get back there.
Well, Gin's like kind of looking around for Fennica.
You find them pretty quick. They are playing cards and winning a lot of money from like 6 disgruntled Lagooners.
So he's gonna walk up and excuse himself into, I guess, the... He's gonna see if there's like an open seat for the card game or whatever.
Sure. Yeah. Fennica just like splays a hand as if to say, help yourself.
Okay, so Kane sits at the table, playing cards, he's gonna go... So, what's the deal with this place exactly? Why is it that we can be ourselves in here?
Oh, well, this is technically the only establishment here in Gnostos that is fielded from outside of Gnostos. None of us are natives. Well, actually, no, there's a couple, but they're informants.
So, how does that work with the whole Gnostos rearranges itself thing a lot?
Oh, that happens because of the nature of Arium. Do you know anything about them?
He's gonna think... Should I make a history roll?
Essentially, Gnostos is attuned to the hearts of the Arium. And, well, when... I don't know how much background information, so I'm just going to start from the top. Ariums have split hearts. One will have half of the same heart that another has the other half of. And if they get too close, they go into a frenzy, and bad things happen. Like I was saying, Gnostos itself is attuned to that process, and it automatically reconfigures itself to make sure that specific Arium don't get too close to one another.
Alright. Does that affect...
We have to be a little careful with that, but also I've got some boys working on something similar to the Emelite University Matrix that will significantly dampen the effects of that particular phenomenon inside these walls. It's a pretty complicated issue, though. Why do you ask?
I had a run-in with a couple of those shifted creatures.
And
we were told that might happen to us.
Fennica, like, reaches across and lifts a bit of your bandana and, like, turns your chin to the side to, like, get a better look at your face. And then, like, gets up out of the chair they were sitting at and gives you, like, more of a full body appraisal, moves around to the back. I don't see any wounds. Are you sure?
So, Do we have to be wounded for it to happen? Like, what's going on? Like, does the Aurium transformation you've had us go through prevent that?
Oh, that's what you're talking about. That's a rumor. That's not going to happen to you.
Do you know the cause then? But that might be no.
Of shifteds?
Yeah.
No. The reason I was checking for wounds is because, like, they're not things you want to fuck with.
I will contain my excitement then.
Unless you do want to fuck with them? They give a bit of a probing smile. I know where you could probably find some.
Well, I'm not one to always leap in without knowledge. What exactly would a wound from one of those entail?
I don't think it would be anything particularly out of the ordinary as far as wounds go. They're just really good at inflicting them.
Huh.
They fall into four different categories. There's screamers, there's clickers, and there's silence. Clickers are kind of omnidirectional transports for the other two. Screamers make it so you can't do anything, and silence kill you.
Joy.
The fourth one is probably the most unfortunate. It's usually a composite of two of the others. Also usually larger. And harder to pin down, I guess.
Ah. Now then, you don't know the root cause. Are they actually people? Like,
oh no, I'm pretty sure I know the root cause. It just doesn't have to do with us.
Ah.
It. You guys know who. Razorface is a weird relationship. Scott, actually, I have to go consult my notes. 1 second. Fenica just kind of scoops up everyone else's money that they had won and disappears. As they're leaving, they beckon for you to follow if you choose.
Yeah, Kane's gonna follow.
So as you go with Fenica to their room, they pull out a whole bunch of papers, and it looks like some of them look official, some of them look like what Fenica has postulated on theories and whatnot, but theories that aren't 100% set in stone. Oh, no, it's the golems that have to do with Razorface. The shifteds, they just, like, ruffle through a bunch more papers and just throw some journals open. Has to do with a place called Jericho. That's what we call our place, right?
In relation to Gnosis?
Fenica nods.
I believe I've heard that tossed around, yeah.
And down here it says Man at the Threshold. Did you know anything about that?
Kane kind of just looks off into the distance and yeah, I might know something about that. Like, out of character, that was like what Epsomnius was or something?
The threshold is the big gate Epsomnius is waiting at, and Epsomnius is cosplaying as a man at the threshold. However, doesn't seem to be working out.
Yeah. He was like, wait a minute.
Probably told a bit about
Tendarier's
quest, what he knows about it.
I've been over Adante with I've been over with Adante about this a couple of times, I think.
Yeah. Some of my memory's spotty, but yeah. Alright, back in character. Yeah, okay. guess I got someone to ask questions to sometime then. But wait a minute. Does magic work okay while we're in these halls?
No.
No?
Ugh. You might want to talk to Sayako about magic. She's kind of found a way to finagle it.
At the cost of looking very strained to do it.
Yeah, well.
So. It'd be nice to be able to send a message without having a major headache looking thing. I don't know, Sayako strained herself pretty bad.
Sayako casted magic?
Yeah.
Was anybody around?
Unfortunately, but...
Can you knock on her head for me?
Will do. But thankfully, aside from the one observant fellow named Ilium, who I believe you owe a debt to, and...
Oh...
some other lady that we were talking to about the shifteds.
Are you gonna be heading back that way?
Honestly, I got no idea. We might have a run-in with them again, but...
Could you... please? Fennica just gives you a slightly pleading smile.
Can I please?
They just, like, start to push all of their winnings that they had put on their desk over to you. Let's maybe consolidate a bit of that debt.
Alright.
Don't want to see him in person, though. That's why you're here. Consider it as thanks for all this free information I give you.
Yeah.
They take out a cigarette and just deep inhale.
Yeah,
and down the hall, a fire alarm goes off.
Oh. Eh.
Because of the cigarette?
Yes, because of the cigarette.
Okay.
Should you really be doing that if that fire alarm's going? Whatever. I'll see about.
If you're gonna bring up X's, I'm gonna smoke wherever the fuck I want to.
Okay. Ah, yeah, young whippersnappers.
Fennica shakes their head. Alright, and back to Amalia, Sayako, and Sleeping Cecil.
Hey, what's going on with Virgil?
So, I don't know if... And this is maybe something I should have thought about. You might need a brief replacement character, Caro.
Given how long this whole reconstitution thing is going on?
Yeah,
how long it took,
It depends pretty explicitly on what the Primaveral chooses to do next, and before he makes that choice, there's a lot of potential interaction between Cecil and the Primaveral.
So, let's ask what Cecil is doing then, shouldn't we?
Cecil is BRB.
Also, if you remember back at the Sepulcher, Primaveral is, like, there just as everything. He's not currently in an avatar. And it looks like that's the form that he just takes right now.
Spooky.
I'd like to figure out exactly what Amalia, Sayako, and Cecil's body want to be up to. Like, is Amalia going back to Razorface? Is Sayako going with Amalia? I believe you had just filled Sayako in on everything that happened in the Hecatoncator and everything. Okay. So the portal's still open behind you, Amalia.
My question is, why would you want to be hooked right back up with that thing?
What?
Sorry, not thing. Guy.
You think... If you're talking about Virgil, he's weird.
Well,
there should really be a term for when you bond with your kidnappers, but I have no idea what that is.
She looks back at Cecil, who's laying unconscious. Stares at him for a good solid, like, not gonna say a whole minute, but like a good maybe 15 seconds.
Cecil continues to have the agency of someone who is sleeping.
We are, yeah, you're right, we are not going to get anywhere.
You can wake up whenever you choose, by the way, Cecil.
It's how it is right now.
What is that level 4 harm, by the way? Oh, sorry, yeah, no, go on.
So Amalia is looking around for a second, and she shouts, Kvi!
Well, and then she notices Kvi isn't there?
Yeah, Catherine is
this not is there. This is a big show.
It's a big what?
It's a big show that I'm not going to do because it's 1:30 in the morning.
I believe Catherine is in the Iron Streets right now.
Yeah. I mean, maybe it didn't take me that long to figure out.
No, it's going to take you a bit.
Okay.
I live for Catherine's solo adventures. I would never miss this opportunity.
I mean, if you want, it's fine.
All right, great. So, Catherine, you, I thought there was more of a plan between Amalia and Sayako, but I guess not.
No, there is. There is a plan. Amalia was getting Kvi's input on it first.
Okay, all right, never mind. Back to the plan, then.
Okay, so, having not got a response, Amalia's gonna sit there and just gonna think. Think.
You know, there was a while back there when I felt a sort of connection with this guy. Can't really explain it. One of those things that is like very esoteric, I suppose.
Amaya looks up the Primavera.
No. And she points right at Cecil's unconscious form. This guy right here. Don't know what it is, but just familiar presence in him.
Well, he's personable enough. I mean, I've felt the urge to kill him least out of everyone I've traveled with.
Does Sayako still sense that?
Nope.
No. Okay.
Okay.
Well.
But hold on. But Sayako does feel like while she's focusing on it, she feels the weirdest sensation of just this still water up above her ankles, as if she's standing in a puddle that's 6 inches deep. And as soon as it's focused on, it goes away.
That causes a breath to sort of catch in her throat.
How could he get us all from? We were all in. Then we were here.
I hold that thought. She's gonna try and follow that sense again.
Roll a charisma check.
Alright. And charisma. Don't fail me, +4 charisma.
You get the incredibly resolute sense that Calliope is alive.
Alright, so she kind of like looks off in a direction as an ear flicks. By the way, in the downtime, she's turned back to normal form. So, in ear flicks, she's like, she's gonna keep trying to follow that sensation.
Like I said, you're only getting like very brief flashes of it, and when you did that charisma check, that was you trying to follow the sensation. The sense of water around your feet didn't come back. It was just that strange, like, assurance of Calliope's existence.
So as it fades, she's gonna look back at Amalia and she's like, well, I don't know about Cecil, but I do have good news.
So Amalia still mourned herself. She registers that you're talking to her. She looks at herself. I am so sorry. What were you saying?
Never mind. So, Cecil.
No, he's important. What? Look, I'm not that busy. I don't have time for you.
Okay. Call me crazy, but I think my brother Calliope, the one that was traveling with you, I think he's still alive. And she's kind of just pacing around, just sort of like kind of in
looking
a holy shit moment.
Not there.
Yeah, that's amazing, Cycle. It's amazing. It's like I told you that about 2 days ago.
No, but like I can feel him out there somewhere. Oh my god.
Is this the weird sibling link bullshit?
Yeah, this is the weird sibling link bullshit. And she's just kinda like pacing in the spot, just trying to like sort of like process this information. And then she shakes her head and she's like, alright, follow up on that later. And she looks
actually,
back.
I do have a question about that. How did you not know he was in command?
Well, it's gonna sound silly, but I was just doing my normal thing of investigating things up there, the sage told me to, and then I felt my hand start to hurt, and well, I followed that feeling and found him at the other end in a jail cell. So,
remind me, did everyone here start out in command? Is there anyone who started out apart from Cecil who started out here in Narzareth?
Right now, I think you two are the only ones in the room other than Cecil?
Yeah, but just as a general point.
Virgil and Catherine were also in Canaan at the time, yeah.
As was Albus.
Yeah, but Albus isn't here.
Yes, but I'm sure there's a story implication, he's saying. So the answer is yes. Everyone started in Canaan and then got warped to here.
Cyrus comes down the stairs and just very politely sits down, folds his hands together in his lap and waits.
Why don't you start out with me? So Amalia looks up. So, God,
I
And she suddenly realizes that she has been just rambling on to herself for about 5 minutes and sees Cyrus sitting next to us. Oh, sorry, can I help?
And it is not Cyrus's voice that comes out of Cyrus when he says, oh, I'm just watching. Don't mind me.
Right.
Well, that easy kind of socially awkward, creepy thing that Cyrus may say. Am I to presume I'm speaking with Lazarus?
He nods and says, actually, now that you bring up awkwardness, I suppose my worst icebreaker would do. What would it take to get you to take me through there with you? And he nods to the open portal.
Well, go back to... Why? Do you even know where that goes?
Yes and no. I know it leads to the center of a problem. One that I might be versed in. Do I know exactly where that might be? Not exactly. And before you ask my intentions, it's not to help. It's to study.
Yeah, I gathered that much. A better question is, what's it worth?
What's it worth to me?
What's it worth to you to go through that portal?
Bargaining. I hate bargaining. What do you want?
For info. Ask for info.
Cecil wakes up.
Alright, Cecil wakes up. Legit?
No cap, legit.
Alright.
So she holds up she holds up 3 fingers.
Before you get to those 3 things, what's Cecil waking up look like?
What does the level 4 harm look like? Shit ass.
Level 4 harm does not seem to manifest.
Oh, great. Cecil goes, and like sits up, and looks around at Amalia, 3 fingers up, and at Cyrus, who is sitting not like Cyrus, and Sayako, if I'm correct, standing or still sitting?
She's standing.
Standing. And there's like probably a 15-second pause where they all make eye contact. And
Lazarus
just
wags his fingers flirtatiously at you, Cecil. Good morning.
No, carry on. Cecil rests their head on the armrest a little bit further up and just kind of listens.
Back to this dreadful trading business. 3 things.
Three questions, three answers.
Suppose I have given you a bit of a leg up on me, haven't I? For one portal, Nimrod.
Oh, I'm not saying I'm going to trade them all in just now, and I'm not saying you have to trade all yours in just now.
And I'm not saying that I'm ever going to need to ask you a question again. Except, wait, I am never going to have to ask you a question again, so... One.
You want to bet on it?
Cyrus/Lazarus pinches the bridge of his nose. And closes his eyes and says, I'm not a gambling man. And any gambles that I don't know, I'll win. So yes, what are you wagering?
Oh, nothing. I'll just hold my two questions in reserve for when you come crawling back.
I don't like your tone.
I don't like any of this situation. But we must make the best of what we have.
He looks to you, Cecil, and says, it's a shame that I had to meet the best of you first. Back to you, Amalia. One question, and then, you know, whatever horrible dehumanizing joke that second part must have been, whenever they come up. What do you want?
Tell me about the Tenebrae operation in the A Factory.
Tenebrae operation in the A Factory. Don't you think that's worth a little bit more than me going through a portal?
At this,
I don't know. Can you make your own portal?
At this, I think Cecil just kind of raises, like extends their arm to the left, pointing at Lazarus, without particularly looking away from the ceiling. As Death in the West, crawling up their arm, just kind of extends, not to reach them necessarily, but to get close enough to possibly reach them, as it extends out into basically like this disgusting Bosch painting. I'm going to roll intimidation, don't worry. As they say, you know, I can cut the link that you have to this little charade at any moment. I mean, Cyrus, nice as he may be, is not particularly worth the destruction of this entire operation, so please listen to the woman. May I roll intimidation?
If you want comprehensive information about the operation, the Tenebrae, and the A Factory, you will have to show me the A Factory, and then I'll be able to tell you. I can 100% assuredly testify that the Sect of Prophecy has no situatedness here, other than myself. Otherwise, why would we send young Cyrus?
At the moment, looks like you're doing it for shits and giggles.
Cecil kind of smiles.
Why would I need to go through the damn portal?
Listen, it's not up to me to tell you how to get your own people killed. You're doing a great job of it yourself.
What's so bad about the portal again? Why are we not, and Cecil yawns, looking at the two of them, why aren't we just letting the nice, stupid man do his thing?
Amalia has quite the firm grasp on leverage.
Yeah.
Oh.
Yeah, right. He values it too. Alright, fine. We'll see the factory, you tell me what's going on there. You can come for the portal.
And on the off chance that the Tenebrae aren't doing anything with the A Factory, you're not going to kill me? Great, perfect.
Well, it wouldn't be killing you, would it? Unless... Wait, and then Cecil's eyes, like, underneath the mask widen as a plume of steam pops out. It's just like, are you risking your consciousness by doing this? They just kind of look, almost surprised at how the possibility of fragility of this person.
Maybe I am. Maybe I'm not. Maybe life's not worth living if there's not a little bit on the line. The real question you should be asking is, do I trust the person I'm inhabiting with my consciousness? The answer to that is a little bit, idiotic if you can't figure it out.
Yeah, I wouldn't.
I do believe not 5 seconds ago you said you were not a gambling person.
Lazarus looks at you, Amalia, smirks, and taps their head. At least you're astute, And I will say I enjoy it when more astute people wrangle my arm behind my back rather than ruffians, I suppose. So, portal time?
As you wish. I need to have a word with Cecil before I go.
Oh, yes.
And she's going to turn to Cecil and she's going to say, I need you to do me a little, two little favors.
Okay.
What? First off, I need you to take over the kidnapping operation.
Okay. And what's two?
Tell me exactly what the Primavera Sepulcher looks like.
Lazarus gets up to go through the portal.
Cecil looks back at Lazarus and then back to Amalia, not particularly caring about this whole exchange, as they continue. Well, you see, the last thing the Primavera and I had done was the destruction and construction of the Windchime, the big kind of similar thing that we saw with the many-armed fellow, yeah, like that. But it actually did have a bell in it, and I put it back together. But prior to that, it was in, you know, disarray, very snowy, not good. Kind of looked like I was, you know, it looked a lot more fractally and exploded, tectonic plate-esque, if that makes any sense. Not exactly an.
Describe what a norm looks like.
Just to continue, Lazarus does go through the portal.
Cool.
Yes. Amalia's going to turn around and say, Zayago, can you keep an eye on him for a moment?
Hey, Sayako's going to approach Amalia and kind of drop her voice into like a very low sort of like, she's basically going to talk to Amalia under her breath and he's like, hey, so if there's anything else you'd like me to follow up on, I could probably do that in my own time.
Amalia smiles. I think I'm going to get answers to some questions I have a little sooner rather than later.
Well, just an offer to consider before you step through that portal. Only lasts until you step through that portal, and then after that I can't guarantee anything. But, you know.
Are you talking to Lazarus?
She's talking to Amalia.
Okay, alright.
I appreciate it. We do need to talk a little more once this is done, but and she's gonna turn back to Cecil. Tell me what you see when you look at the Primavera's world.
I'm not going to be doing the voodoo bullshit because I'm a bit nervous as to what I possibly unleashed. So you know what? I'm feeling a bit a tad bit disjointed. To let you know the brief, you know, cliff notes as to what happened. I'm pretty sure either me breaking the wind chime or Virgil. Oh God, Virgil. Virgil doing his stunt caused the Primavera some amount of great pain, but then putting it back together kind of reconstituted the plane. All in all, it's vaguely back to normal. I didn't see Virgil. The plane looked scuffed.
Frozen lake, middle of nowhere, expanding on forever. Alright. And she turns around and goes through the portal.
Hold up. So, Catherine, you've been off on your own for the past half hour.
Yep.
Walking through the iron streets, taking little turns here and there, and paying attention to why exactly the roads seem to be a little different every time you start to retrace your steps. Thankfully, the verticality of this place and the tall buildings and landmarks make it kind of easy to find your way back to like the important bits, like the places that will lead you back up to the ballast bridges and to Lagoon and to the little hunter's hall that Ilium had met you at.
Mm-hmm.
And you're looking for this address. It's down what should be a couple of forked streets that aren't there. It's just what looks like three or so buildings that could exist by themselves, fused together. There's joints in the road you're standing on, and they just finished reconfiguring into their current position. And so you realize, with a little bit of disappointment, that the reason you can't get to Sarkic yet is because his road isn't accessible right now.
Not even if I climb?
Maybe if you climb. You want to try?
I mean, sure. Why not? What's the worst that can happen? Falling to my death?
So Dandeplant picks you up and just starts to use its climbing movement to just ambiently move up, and your disappointment is very short-lived as you look up to the rooftops of the buildings that you're just about to be scaling with the aid of your pet piranha plant, and you see the Umbriskine a few thousand feet above you, except it is not like, it's not idle in the way it was before you messed with it. It's also not like vertical in the way it was. It's horizontal. It's far up in the sky, and it's like almost spread eagle, like a flying bird, except it's not moving. It's stationary, and you feel it looking at you. And this playful feeling comes over you, like the thrill of a chase.
Huh. Well, I grin and try to cast Fly on myself, and then remember I can't use magic.
And its body starts rapidly reconfiguring, a bunch of black cubes just moving around and restructuring themselves as it twists into a helix and then just starts jankily snaking around until it just immerses itself in the clouds that are constantly above Gnostos and disappears from view. Is it at this point that you head back to Lagoon?
I guess.
As you step through the front door, you see Amalia seemingly having just finished a conversation with Cecil, and Sayako is there, but not in her Arium form. And immediately before Amalia passes through a red-shifted portal open in front of her, it closes. And Gnostos as a whole quakes underfoot.
Alright, okay. So, that was Razor Freeze?
Seems to be. Definitely one of his portals.
Okay, I forget. Do I know about the meeting you guys had with Razor Freeze?
No.
Okay. So, do we have any idea of how to defend ourselves?
What?
From Razor Freeze. I assume he's here to try to kill us again?
No, he's...
Sorry, what'd you say?
Stuart?
So Amalia. Is going to. Upon seeing the thing fade away, does she still have the device?
No. You throw the device, it expands into the portal. You're outside the exit gate, so it would have been the entry gate that decompresses back into the device.
So wait, throws the thing, he goes for the portal, he comes out on the other side, and then the portal closes, that's it, he has to go back to where he started to get the thing.
Seems like that is the functionality, yes.
Just saying that's a design flaw, but okay. Alright, so Amalia sees this happen. And there's just an absolute cannot be dealing with this shit right now.
Well, is he coming to kill us or not?
No, he's not coming to kill us. He's on our side now.
Since when?
Hey, Psycho, did you still want to do me that favor?
She had kind of taken to sit down and just sort of spin a single coin on a table, and she's like, huh? What?
Can you guys give me up to everything that's happening here? I am going to go deal with this. Thanks.
All
and then
right.
She's going to bolt out of the dwarf and head back the normal way.
All right. And just because Catherine / Shawnee isn't feeling great, that's, I believe, going to be the end of session stinger. EXP time. Catherine. I have an intense curiosity about how the world around me works for science.
Yeah. Can I bring home a shadow person to study?
You want to bring home a shifted?
Hey, that falls under both my flaw and
does.
My idea.
Yeah, once again, Catherine, do you have an off switch for playing like this? Because you're always really on point with it. Jeez. I would also give it to, like, why do I need to wait for the streets to change and going to, like, physically investigate? That's a curiosity about how the world works.
Yeah.
All right, Amalia. Everyone deserves a choice in the person they want to be in life.
Oh boy. That extends to the peasants.
That's true. Alright, fair. Alright. I'd rather harm come to me than anyone else I know, and I'm ill at ease if I can't influence what's happening.
She's the only person that can go back to She's the only person that can't go back to the Sepulchre, and that is fucking with her right now, although she has plans.
Okay. I was gonna ask if that was on screen, but I like the I like that.
It absolutely was, because when Cecil fucking dropped, and Amalia had that moment of freezing.
That's true.
That happened.
Yeah, you're right. Alright, Cecil. Drive. Aggress the world until it leaves me and mine alone.
I would argue that the threat of violence to both Lazarus and Cyrus could be that.
Yeah,
but also
I agree with that.
Okay.
Since I noticed that you didn't change it / add anything to it, just a reminder that you can do that since this is technically your second clock.
Yep, I know.
Flaw. Unafraid of death, terrified of loss. Totally willing to help try and give a sick dank Capri Sun to the Primaveral, even though you realized what was very, very possible.
Yeah, Cecil was not afraid of the Primavera dying. Cecil was afraid that the Primavera would be too weak to assist him.
It feels really good on my end being able to fucking put your characters go bye-bye to a 20% chance two sessions in a row.
Yeah, I was expecting it to be higher. I was thinking 50.
Virgil, you weren't on screen a lot, and it was my fault. So I'm going to give you a compensation EXP.
I will also see that I get one from figuring out stuff of Eden and Jericho, because I'm in a weird valley place.
All right, fair. Yep. Kane.
Hello, I changed my ideal since I got a point last time.
PogChamp. Excitement of the new challenges occurring in this strange setting and seeing the world as he knows it on the brink of ruin once more spurs a desire to help set the situation straight with a battle-tested might. Or if you're to go out in a blaze of glory trying. The youngsters shouldn't fall here. That's sick.
I love Kane.
Kane seemed a lot more involved today.
Yeah.
It was kind of Pog.
I did change the ideal after all.
All right. Lack of social tact from being a slight recluse, more so especially after the large altercation of Old Nartzareth. Oh, you know what Kane did do? Like, as soon as the cat was out of the bag, he's like, yeah, I'm not from around here. This place sucks.
Yeah.
Yeah, he could have fucking sold off just Sayako, but...
Yeah, what?
I'd have done it.
Mortal's wife is fickle and fleeting. Sorry, what?
I was just going to say, it's like the cat was already out of the bag with the aliens. Let's start in one for person knowing, right? Right.
That's true. Mortal life is fickle and fleeting. I would see that candle preserved, and failing that, well spent.
I was going to speak up when I didn't get to do it, but I was going to speak up when Cecil threatened Lazarus.
Flashback time.
Whoa.
Sort of sidestepping in and just kind of waving her hands in front of the scythe, like, kind of like, hey, now.
No, I omit this.
Okay.
Simply put, Robert does not get EXP. No, I'm joking.
I like that scene. I can be a stickler for tradition and inflexible in my thinking. You fucking specifically wanted to go back to Lagoon constantly so you could change out of your work clothes.
Trying to think of a better example.
Flexible in my thinking. Violent. For tradition. Oh, yeah, no, Fenneca fucking told you not to out yourself, and you didn't even, like, you woke up and you're like, yeah, I'm not from around here, just checks nails, I'm kind of a big deal.
I'm something of a legend myself.
She's kind of just, didn't really have a sciencey way to explain emitting a burst of sunlight to fuel a giant laser cannon.
Could have just, pipe leak.
So she's just
kind of
like,
leak in the building before.
It's like, yeah, I kind of did mad. Like, that's what she wanted to express, is that she used magic to do that.
Yeah. All right, and I think that's everyone.
I think so.
Okay, bye-bye.
Bye-bye.